Hello friends, in this talk, in our second day, I want to present to you new paradigms for solutions today. What do we mean by new paradigm? What do we mean by a paradigm? We know it, but just to explain briefly, a paradigm is a method, a system by which something is done. Everything in culture is a paradigm. The way we run school is a paradigm. The parish is a paradigm. The menu we eat is a paradigm. For example, there is a paradigm about what should be eaten for breakfast, what should be eaten for lunch, there is a paradigm for a get together. There is a paradigm for a workshop. There is a paradigm. Even country systems are paradigms actually. And paradigms are important. Without that, we cannot really function, because culture is made up of a series of paradigms, series of systems. Paradigms are important and we need to follow them. But unless we are also able to change our paradigms, we will not make any real change in our life. We will not become new solutions. So we are talking about how to become new solutions. What is the profile of the new solution needed for the young people of this new world? New young people, new world, new times, new systems, and therefore we also need to be new solutions. Therefore we need to revise our paradigms, our systems of thinking and living that condition us culturally. Okay, so this talk is named as New Paradigms for the solution of today. So here I give you always two terms to contrast. Paradigm actually means that. Therefore, as you will see also in the file that you will receive, the name of the file is Reflection on Religious Life Today, or New Paradigms for Solutions Today. And because a paradigm means shifting from one to the other. So I present to you two sets of words. A solution is not only this, the new solution, but also should be that. In values, for example, a new solution should, it's not enough that he is intelligent, but he should be wise. This is a paradigm shift. It's a paradigm shift in our virtue. Intelligence is intelligence, but wisdom is when love goes along with intelligence, then it becomes wisdom. Intelligence in itself is good, but it can be used for either for good or for bad. Intelligence is like a knife. You can use a knife for doing good. You can use a knife for doing harm. But wisdom is in the hands, it is like the knife in the intelligence in the hands of a man who uses it for love, for building up, for healing, for construction, for sharing, etc. So it's not enough that we remain intelligent solutions, but we need to become wise solutions. It is not enough to be sociable solutions, we need to really become loving solutions. We are very joyful. Solutions are in general very sociable. We realize that we are good for relationships. Hi, how are you? And we crack jokes and we are good company, etc. But are we truly loving people? Sociability is not the same as love. So this paradigm shift also we need to make. From being efficient people, we need to become efficacious people. Efficient, we are efficient in organization, getting things, but efficacy is different from efficiency. Efficacy is spiritual efficiency. That is, when we are able to touch the hearts of people, we are able to bring people to God, inspire people to come closer to God, etc. Then we become efficacious ministers. From being ritual people, we need to become truly spiritual people. We can be going through the rituals, the motions of our daily Eucharist, daily Lords, Vespers, Rosaries, without lacking in any of them. that we say our prayers very regularly can kind of cheat us into the wrong belief, into the illusion that we are actually spiritual people. Not necessarily. We need to become a spiritual people from being ritual people. We need to become just people from being charitable people. This is a very important paradigm shift. We in general solutions are benefactors. We would like to do a lot of charity works because we can collect money, we have agencies, and we can make money in our own institutions, and we distribute a lot of services to those who do not have. I am the rich man, I am the benefactor, I give it to you, charity. But justice is a harder virtue, and that is a more lasting service that we need to do to the society and to the young people. Actually, what people will not need charity if they are given justice. And therefore, in our method of thinking and working, we need to move from charity model of work towards justice model of work in as much as possible. I am not saying that in every little thing we can forget about charity and do justice. But justice is defined as the minimum of charity. Without justice, charity cannot be done, because justice is defined as the minimum of charity. The minimum of charity itself is justice. Therefore, how can we practice charity without doing justice? It's a thought that we need to seriously think about. And that simply means also that we need to move from being benefactors to the friend, to be friends of the poor. I remember an old superior once, when I was a cleric, told me, you know, I was, okay, we'll do something for the poor, but for lunch we'll invite our friends. So we understood that our friends are not the poor, our friends are our equals, the other important elite society. But the poor will be given also something because they are poor. They are our destinatari. They are our target group instead of, no. The real paradigm shift that we are called to make today is from being benefactors to being friends of the poor. From being discreet people to be really humble people. We are good at being discreet. We know how to behave discreetly and correctly, courteously. But humility is something very different. Humility is the real recognition of my worth, the worth of the others, God's hand in everything, and taking our place without impinging on or infringing on the freedom of others, and making courageously our own contribution. It is not easy to be humble. It is easy to be discreet and courteous. And so the paradigm shift is that, from being planners to being strategists. This is a little subtle different. We are good for planning simple things like a good feast or a good program, but strategy is something different. Strategy is understanding what is happening behind our culture and our politics, our laws, and our education system, etc., in order to strategize as to how to educate the young towards values. How to bring about basic changes in the society. We are also called to do that, is it not? We are not just to be called, we are not just called to be running just a few institutions, doing a few services, etc., etc. We are called to change society. I remember the famous scene in a film on the life of Jesus, where after calling the first disciples, Jesus is sitting on the boat, and Peter asks him, okay, Jesus, you have called us all to follow you. Okay, we have said, okay, we are. But what are we going to do? And Jesus looks into the horizon and says, we are going to change the world. To change the world. We are not here to, you know, just to do some preaching, to go here, to work one or two miracles here, help a few pure people, poor people. Okay, all that is part of our way of going about. But our goal is to change the world. Therefore, we need to rethink our values and the basic ways in which we think and organize our paradigms. Next, the new solution is an unconventional person like Jesus, like Don Bosco, like, for example, Saint Francis. It is an example that is easy to understand. Jesus was totally unconventional. He was not like anything that they expected him to be. In fact, people thought that he was strange. People thought that he is saying strange things, behaving strangely, he's out of his mind, he works his miracles because he is possessed by the demon, except nobody understood him actually. Nobody understood him. But he understood himself because he knew that the Father understood him and he was in line with his Father. Saint Francis, a beautiful example, is people thought he was a little eccentric. He was not like anything that they thought he should be, and therefore people thought of him strange. Okay, he's a good man but eccentric. Don Bosco himself, his own priest thought he was a little mad. What is this priest leaving his dignity of sacraments of the church, etc., running around with street kids and playing football with them, or I don't know, mingling with them and living with them. They thought that he was a little mad, and some of them wanted to put him in an asylum, and we know the story. So actually, people who are centered on the gospel will look a little strange to the others. I have formed four phrases, four by double words that could provoke us to reflection better. That is, a new solution is called to be a creative misfit. Okay, you may laugh at this term, creative misfit. Well, Father, many of us are misfits. Okay, that is true. I mean, I could be a misfit myself. It is easy to be a misfit, but are we creative misfits? Jesus was a creative misfit. Francis was a creative misfit in his society. Don Bosco was a creative misfit in his diocese, among the priests. And therefore, something new, something original, something more beautiful, something more gospel-like was born out of them. Jesus was not like the Messiah that they expected him. He was not a Messiah that came to serve their interests. He was a Messiah who came to serve the interests of God. And therefore, people who are truly centered on the gospel will always look a little misfit. So don't take me wrongly. My idea is not to say that we should become misfits. But it is in the combination of these two contradictory ideas that something new is born. It is like thesis, antithesis, and the synthesis is something greater than either the thesis and the antithesis. Second phrase that I have coined is obedient rebels. Solutions are called to be obedient. Very true. We need to be obedient to our vows, to our promises, our consecration, and to the church, to the congregation, to our superiors. But at the same time, just blind obedience, just doing things because we were told, and just doing only those things that we are told, is not actually obedience. It is contrary to obedience. The word rebel, I have put there, obedient rebels, means in the sense some little rebellion within us, in the right sense, makes us go beyond what is asked of us, to do more, to be risk takers, to be entrepreneurs, enterprising people. You told me to do this, but I have done much more. That's what I mean by obedient rebel. It's easy to be rebels, you know. Just criticize the church or superiors or congregation, easy to be rebels, but difficult to be obedient rebels. We are called to be chaste romantics. The chapter calls for this continuously in using other terms. We are called to be chaste romantics. That is, we are called to be highly, intensely loving and passionately loving people. Romantic stands for that. That is, people who fall in love. Francis was a romantic. He fell in love with the earth, with the sun, with the moon, with water, with plants, with animals, with trees, with people, because he fell primarily in love with his Lord. Don Bosco was a romantic person. And his purity was part of his romantic nature. He was able to be truly romantic because he was pure. In the same way, Jesus was a romantic person. He loved everything that God made because everything was good, everything was beautiful. Love, he was love personified. We are called to be romantics, but we need to be chaste romantic. Romanticism that avoids lust. Lust is by definition self-pleasure seeking. When the self pleasure seeking is absent, love becomes romantic. We can truly and openly, expressively love everybody, and nobody will misunderstand us because we are not seeking anything for ourselves except the joy of being, joy of loving, and the joy of being loved, which is right. So we are called to be chaste romantics. In being with young people, we need to, that's what Don Bosco said, it's not enough to love them, they should know that you love them. How do you make them know that you love them? Because by doing things by way of, by signs, by our expansive expression of our love, all that, I call it to form into an attractive phrase, I call it chaste romanticism. Chaste, being romantics in a chaste manner. And we know the importance of chastity in working for the young people and in our consecrated life. And the fourth phrase that I place in front of you is that we are called to be loving agitators. It's a phrase that I like very much. As I said, these are two terms always, one trying, one seemingly in contradiction with the other. Loving agitator. It's easy to claim that I'm a loving person because I simply am a pacifist. I agree to everything. I say I love you. Ciao, come stai, ti voglio bene. And in Italian, they say like that. I love you. Let's not fight. No. But a lover is also an agitator when needed. When the children are in danger, the mother becomes violent. Not because she loves violence, but her love demands that. Okay, this we see everywhere. And for the sake of the young, and there is no need to explain too much. Just look at the figure of Jesus. Jesus was love personified, but he was an agitator. He did not shrink from condemning people. And when he spoke about the young, the condemnation that he reserved for those who scandalize the young are the most serious condemnations. A stone should be tied around the neck of a fellow and thrown into the sea, etc., etc. He was truly a loving agitator. The new solution, therefore, in that sense, is also a countercultural person. Countercultural person. He follows the spirit of the Beatitudes. We have spoken about that. He takes courageous stance on education and globalization. He changes the value system underlying our works according to the values that we spoke about. He has a different success indicators, etc., etc. He is countercultural, unconventional, as I said. Accordingly, as the chapter wants us, we need to change also our formation. Not only the initial formation, but also our permanent formation. According to this paradigm, we need to form ourselves to conviction and not only to conformity. Often our formation is accused of creating people who conform and do not come out with strong convictions. We need to form people for the mission and not for the institutions, in the sense, to be an administrator, to be a teacher, to be a rector, to be a catechist or whatever it is. We seem to be forming people in order to fit into certain positions and posts and roles rather than for the mission itself. Suppose you send out three or four fellows into an area and say, you are Salesians, you live as a community, but we don't define your mission. You do whatever you can. Have we created solutions who know how to create mission for themselves according to the situation, according to the needs of the place? Have we created them? Therefore, we need to form people for the mission and not just for certain roles, qualifying them just for certain roles, because they cannot do anything outside those roles. We need to form people for sharing and not for competition. How much competition there is in the church between various congregations? We are sometimes kind of quietly dissatisfied or let's say unhappy that other congregations may be capturing important places and we are not yet there. It's a kind of competition within our communities, competition within the Salesian family, competition. within among ourselves competition. We need to also as sharing in our running our institutions, sports, etc. We may be unwittingly forming our youngsters for constant competing and therefore defeating the others, overtaking the others, being one step ahead of the others, winning over the others, rather than for the spirit of sharing. We need to form people ourselves for creativity and not just upkeep. Creativity, not just upkeep. This institution is there, this work is there, you just keep it up. No. We need to be constantly changing and creative. We need to form people who can look at and practice their vows not as ends in themselves, but as important conditions for the mission. Vows in terms of the mission. Obedience to another person in itself does not make sense. Why should I be obedient to another person? But I am obedient because I am committed to the poor in a particular society. Chastity, let's say celibacy. What is the value of celibacy in itself? No sense. Why can't I get married? After all, most of the Old Testament saints were married, and God made man for woman and woman for man. I can get married, but I remain. I practice the vow of chastity, and I remain celibate for a mission. So this vow in itself, celibacy, for example, chastity is something else. Celibacy does not make. And again, poverty in itself, why can't I enjoy material goods that God has created? I limit my needs in order to be more effective in the mission. So vows as a means for the mission, not simply as values or ends in themselves. I need to be also formed to face the world, not only to remain inside our sacristies or our convents and things like that. How do I face the world? Has my formation trained me to enter the government circles or to enter a police station, to go to a court, to deal with the secular groups? Or am I capable of being effective only inside my own little protected ambient? We need to move from monastic spirituality to a political spirituality or social spirituality. Monastic spirituality is not bad, but that is meant. In fact, the great monks and fathers of the desert became socially highly relevant later. And therefore, we are not, monastic spirituality means that we are not meant to be like the monks of the Middle Ages. Our spirituality is social. We are there in the world. That is why even our congregation has all secular names. Even for our organization, like in provincial inspector or province or ispettoria and things like that. We need to be formed to be radical and not merely for cosmetics. This is very important. The previous chapter told us that we need to follow the gospel in a radical manner. By being mystics, prophets and servants, we have not truly understood that in its true condition and in its true meaning. And I conclude by presenting to you a list of two columns, a paradigm shift that summarizes many of the things that I have already told you. New heaven and new earth, a paradigm shift in life and mission. Okay, so we need to move from to. I just read them because the time is already going ahead. From working for the people, we need to learn to work with the people. From being only in congregation-centered works, institution-centered works, to be in people-centered mission, people-centered works, community organizations. We need to move from our community to EPC as the community, that is a larger community that works for the young. And in fact, we need to learn to work with many other communities. We need to move from our traditional works to really meeting the needs of the young people. From institution building to movements building. Institutions are good, but they serve in a limited way. But movements can reach out in a big way. So we need to spend our energy also to build movements and not be happy only with the individual institutions. as I told you already, from charity model to justice model, from our own works to networking with other forces, networking with creating larger communities for good. From prudent administration, we need to move to transparency and open public declaration of our intentions, our assets, etc. From kindness to the poor to identification of the poor. As I told you, this is a kind of summary list of many things that I have already said. From monastic spirituality to political or social spirituality. From offering services to creating movements. From false universality to contextualization, that is being committed to particular groups of people. For example, we are committed more to young people than for anybody. We are committed more to the poor rather than in general to everybody else. So these are false universality should be avoided. We should be contextualized. From private ministry to public participation in life. Participation in public life. From administration to animation, a term that is constantly used in our chapter, from administration, leaving it to lay people, we need to move towards roles of animation. And in short, we need to move from what we can call the world to what we should call the kingdom. The kingdom was a central passion in the life of Jesus, and therefore he said, the kingdom is burning in my heart, and I can't, that is my food, that is my sleep, that everything is, you know, it did not give him rest. We need to move from the way that the world thinks to the way that the kingdom is organized. Kingdom is, what is this kingdom? Kingdom is a situation in the world. If God were really ruling the world, what would this world be? How will this world look? And that is the kingdom. It is, instead of calling the kingdom, we can call it God's reign, God's rule. We need to move towards that, from being people of the world, organizing a few services and activities, saying a few prayers in the meanwhile, because we happen to be religious. It is, no, we need to make a complete paradigm shift of, why am I here? What is my real mission? Why am I doing what am I doing? Why am I praying the way I am praying? Why am I practicing the vows the way I am practicing? Why am I playing a role the way I am doing it? What is my final outcome? What is the final outcome of my work? And how am I called to live? These are questions that we need to ponder. Thank you.